Hello friends. I created this video tutorial with the aim of introducing you to the Tuya Local integration, which allows the Home Assistant smart home control system to manage devices added to Tuya Smart locally. Unlike the more commonly used localtuya integration, which I have also made tutorials about, Tuya Local is much easier to install and configure. In addition, it's easier to add new devices to it, which will be especially appreciated by beginners. The integration is installed using HACS, an add-on that gives access to hundreds of user repositories. For those who haven't installed it yet, in the first part of the video I explain in detail how to do this. If you've already installed HACS, you can skip straight to the second part. Before we begin, as usual, I ask you to like this video to help others interested in smart home topics find it, and to subscribe to my channel if you haven't already. The first part of the tutorial is intended for beginners who are just getting started with Home Assistant. In it, I provide an up-to-date guide on installing the HACS integration. The only requirement for it, besides Home Assistant itself, is that you must be registered on GitHub. It's quick and free. So what is HACS? It's a kind of catalog for a huge number of user integrations, cards, and themes, which automates their installation, updating, and, if necessary, removal. I'll leave a link to it in the video description. I will show the simplest installation method, which requires no effort from you. On the HACS website, go to the Usage section, then to Download HACS, and click this link. It opens a redirection page to Home Assistant. Since I have many Home Assistant servers, I specified a specific IP address. Yours might work with just the name, but the IP address works reliably. One more clarification, whether to open this link. Agree to open it. Now we enter the Home Assistant interface, where we see a window with a message about a missing repository. Everything is fine, that's how it's supposed to be. Click the Add button. This opens the page of the add-on called Get HACS. Install it. Then launch it. Don't touch the startup and auto-update toggles. They are disabled. This add-on needs to be launched only once. After launching, go to the Log tab to check that everything went successfully. The task of this add-on is to download the installation file and create a folder for this integration. After that, it stops and is no longer needed. Previously, all these steps had to be done manually via console commands. This way, much simpler, don't you agree? Next, go to Settings, System, Restart Home Assistant. This is needed so the system recognizes the new integration. After rebooting, go to the Settings menu again and select the Integration section. In the bottom right corner, click the Add Integration button. In the open window, search by name for HACS and select it. Check all the boxes and submit. Since the integration will automatically check for updates to user repositories, it needs access to your GitHub account. To do this, you need to authorize. In this window, a one-time code is shown, which you need to copy and follow the link. That's why I said at the beginning that you need a GitHub account. If you haven't visited the site yet, enter your credentials, or if it remembers you, you'll go straight to the code entry page. Paste it there. Grant permission for HACS authorization on GitHub. It will now be able to check for updates. If everything was done correctly, you will see this window. Return to Home Assistant, and you'll see a message about the successful installation of HACS. The integration creates an icon on the left side of the toolbar. Going into HACS, we enter a catalog that contains a large number of user repositories. We see the names, number of downloads, user ratings, activity, and type. Most often, these are either integrations or interface elements. For example, Xiaomi Mi Auto, a popular integration for working with devices from the Mi Home ecosystem, which supports many more models than the built-in integration that comes with Home Assistant itself. But the topic of today's video tutorial is working with Tuya Smart devices in Home Assistant, usually referring to Wi-Fi devices, since Zigbee devices can be connected directly through ZHA or Zigbee 2 MQTT integrations. Check out the lessons on this topic on my channel. But if you want to control Zigbee devices both in the Tuya app and in Home Assistant, the method shown below will also work. Home Assistant has a built-in Tuya integration, which, after installation, will automatically pull in all supported devices. But it has several significant drawbacks. For example, often only basic control functions are available, while various modes and settings are only available in the Tuya Smart app. But the main issue is that it depends on the internet and access through the cloud server. In the context of local control, the localtuya integration is most often mentioned. I have several tutorials on this topic on my channel, including device reviews where I show the configuration steps using this integration. But there are also some nuances associated with it. In particular, to install it, you need to register on the developer portal and create a separate project, which has a time limit for usage. Therefore, this can also be difficult, especially for beginners. A simpler option is an integration with a similar name, Tuya Local. It also allows Home Assistant to control Tuya devices locally, but is significantly easier to set up and use. Unlike localtuya, this integration has not yet been added to the official HACS catalog, so you need to add it manually. In the top right corner, click the button with three dots and select Custom Repositories. In the video description, copy the link to the Tuya Local repository and paste it into the top field of the pop-up window. In the menu below, select the repository type as Integration. If everything is done correctly, you will see a record about the newly added repository. Now, in the HACS search bar, you can start typing the name of the integration and it will appear in the list of available options. Open it, and in the bottom right corner, click the download button. By default, the latest version is installed, and by the way, updates come regularly. Click download again. After installing the integration, you will receive a notification about the need to restart. Click on it, and then click submit. After that, Home Assistant will restart. After the restart, you can start connecting devices. To do this, go to the Integrations menu. In the bottom right corner, click Add Integration and search for Tuya Local by name. Next, select the first option for automatic data retrieval from the cloud and proceed to the next screen. Instead of registering on the developer site and creating a project like in localtuya, here the authorization mechanism is the same as in the official Tuya integration, through a user key. Where to get it? In the Tuya Smart app, on the Profile tab, select the Settings menu in the top right corner. It looks like a gear. Next, go to the Security Settings tab. There you will find the user code you need. For obvious reasons, I won't show my own code. You need to enter it into this window, and then click this Submit button. The next window will display a QR code. You will need the Tuya Smart app again. On the same Profile tab, the button to the left of Settings opens the QR code scanner. Point the camera at the displayed code, and then confirm the login. After that, you can click this Submit button. In the future, when adding new devices, this step may need to be repeated. But as you can see, it's simple and takes literally 1 minute. Next, the device selection window opens. There are two drop-down menus. The upper one is for selecting a device from the list linked to your Tuya account. The lower one is only needed for devices connected via gateway. In this case, you'll need to specify it as well. Let's start the connection with a power strip that has 4 sockets and 4 USB ports, which is controlled via Wi-Fi. I select it from the list of devices. In this case, the gateway does not need to be specified, so we move to the next step. Since this integration works locally, it needs the device's IP address on the network. The cloud doesn't provide it, so automatic search is launched. Usually, the address is detected correctly and automatically appears in the input field. But just in case, I'll show where to find it manually. In the plugin of the connected gadget, in this case the power strip, go to the General Settings menu. Look for the Device Information section. There is no local IP address here, but there is a physical, MAC, address. Using it, you can find the device in your router's menu, in the Connected Devices section. Copy the local IP address from there, paste it into the corresponding field, and proceed to the next step. Here, the type of your device is determined. In the case of standard devices, everything is detected correctly and there's no need to change anything. If your device is something specific, you might need to try selecting it manually. The final step is naming. You can enter whatever name you find convenient for yourself. You now have control over all the sockets and the USB port block, just like in the app, but here it works locally. In addition, timers have been added for them. If you set one, the selected socket or USB block, which controls all ports simultaneously, will change its state to the opposite once the countdown finishes. Let's now check the operation of a device connected via gateway. To add it, go to the Integrations Devices menu and click the Add button. The sequence of steps is identical, but there may be a situation where you are asked to re-enter the user code and scan the QR code, just like I showed before. In the upper menu, I select the Zigbee socket. This is the version with energy monitoring. Since it is connected through a gateway, in the lower menu I specify which one, because there may be multiple gateways in the system. We check that the correct device was selected and the correct gateway specified, then proceed. The integration again determines the local IP address, but in this case, it's the IP address of the gateway. Also displayed here is the sub-ID of the socket. The device type is detected. I didn't change anything here, and continued. Done. Now there are two devices in the integration. Let's see what entities are available for the socket. There is relay control. This is the main entity. Some entities appeared but are unavailable. These are various settings. On the other hand, they can be configured in the standard app, so it's not critical. A timer is also available. But energy monitoring is available and it works. True, the current is shown in milliamps instead of amps, just like in the app. The readings are accurate. As for the unavailable entities, there's no point in keeping them in the system, especially if you've implemented telemetry mechanisms. You can find lessons on this topic on my channel. Therefore, they can be disabled. Click on each unnecessary entity one by one and go to its settings. And we disable this option. Repeat for each inactive or unnecessary entity. This is especially important in cases where all events are written to the database. By disabling the entities you don't need, you can significantly reduce the size of the database. This is how the socket control menu looks after disabling the unavailable entities. Everything is more compact and convenient. And one more device, the addition of which we'll look at in this tutorial, a lamp with an addressable LED strip working over Wi-Fi. Its feature is that it has many light effects that you would want to control from Home Assistant. The connection process is already familiar, so I'll just show the key steps. From the list of devices, select the desired one. This is the addressable LED strip. You can also find a review of it on my channel, as well as reviews of all the other devices mentioned here. Next is finding the IP address. If it isn't detected, you already know how to find it. Determining the device type, I didn't change anything there either. And finally, the naming. Done. Now we have three devices in the Tuya Local integration. Let's see what we can do with this LED strip. By default, a standard object appears here, light, two setting parameters, and a timer. You can adjust the brightness and choose the color the strip will glow, but only static colors are available in this menu, without effects. Here is also the mode switch. There are three of them. One unnamed mode corresponds to static light. Scenes, these are preset effects. And music, when the strip reacts in sync with sounds. The settings allow you to change the color order. For example, if green lights up instead of red, and set the number of segments in the strip. If desired, you can replace the included strip with your own, as long as it uses the same operating voltage. But where is the effects control? There is another object here, but it is hidden by default. Let's check what it is. Apparently, this is exactly what we need. But to start working with this object, you need to activate it first. The actions are the same as I showed with the socket. Go to the object settings. Now we need to enable it so that it appears in the system. The system warns that you need to wait a bit until it activates. Done. It turned out to be a text field, and after activation it contains the value unknown. In this field, after the next time the lamp is turned on, some kind of code appears. Let's run an experiment. In the Tuya Smart app, I start switching effects, and each new effect is shown here as its own unique code. Accordingly, if you paste the desired code into this field, it will trigger the corresponding effect. You'll have to map the codes yourself. You can test it in the Developer Tools section under Services. Here, select the Text Value Setting Service, then specify the object, and in the Value field, enter the desired code. After launching, the LED strip switches to the effect that matches the code. This can be used in automations, for example, switching effects using different presses on smart switch buttons. Using a version with 6 keys and 3 event types per key, you can assign 18 different effects, or assign custom effects to specific events. For those who prefer using manually written automations, such as in packages like I do, this block looks like this. If you need to manually refresh the list of devices available to the integration, for example, right after adding something new, you can use the reload button, which is available in the settings of any device added to the integration. That's all for now. I hope the video was useful and interesting for you. I would appreciate your likes. They help with promotion on YouTube. If you don't want to miss new videos, subscribe to my channel. In the video description, I will leave links to all the mentioned resources, as well as to my Telegram channels and social media groups for smart home discussions. Join in, it will be interesting. Thanks for your attention. See you next time. Peace to all.